So there's been a lot of news about the Xbox 360 lately, the main catalyst being the shutdown of the 360's online marketplace on July 29th. While any service shutdown is undoubtedly a shame, it's actually almost surprising it lasted as long as it did, existing for nearly twice as long as the similarly recently shut down Wii U and 3DS stores. But if there's any lesson to be learned from the retro community, it's that we'll always find a way to keep things alive, so let's talk about the community efforts to do just that. But before we get into it, let me give a quick shout out to this video's sponsor, PCBWay. I've been getting into developing hardware recently, and for prototyping and manufacturing, PCBWay has never let me down. Everything I've ever ordered from them has arrived quickly and in impeccable quality, almost making me forget how I've just bashed this design together on my laptop. I've also called on them to manufacture existing projects from Xbox mod chips to controller adapters, and the results have always been fantastic. If you're in the need for anything like this, I highly recommend checking them out. And now, back to the 360. First up is the Homebrew Store, brought to you by DERF, one of the maintainers of consolemods.org. This is really cool, it's essentially a package manager like you'd get on Linux, and as a Linux user, I'm a big fan. Once you no longer have to go to individual websites to download apps, you'll never want to go back, especially when it comes to console homebrew, which is often spread across various forums, personal sites, and file sharing platforms, many of which have died out over the last 20 years and were never properly archived. That being said, the homebrew scene on the 360 is definitely a lot less developed than the OG Xbox and even the PS3, I think largely owing to the difficulty in modding it for the average person. There are emulators for sure, but if you're coming from those other systems, you may be a little disappointed by the overall selection and quality of what's available.
The nuclear weapons disposal facility on Shadow Moses Island in Alaska's Fox Archipelago was attacked and captured. Captured by next generation special forces.
But hey, that doesn't take anything away from the fact that having a homebrew store is great. If it were up to me, everything would have a package manager. Next, let's talk about ZFU Spoofer. ZFU is the name of the OG Xbox emulator on the 360, and officially there was only a limited subset of Xbox games that it supported. However, community efforts have widened this support considerably, originally by simply forcing every game to load, many of which worked fine despite never being officially tested by Microsoft, but it's still an emulator and compatibility isn't 100%. But ZFU Spoofer aims to help that out. Essentially, there isn't just one ZFU, there are multiple versions used depending on which game you're trying to play. Different versions of the emulator play certain games better than others, and ZFU Spoofer lets you choose which version to launch so you can hopefully find one that works best. This doesn't guarantee that every single game will work, but does make a huge difference with certain games. In fact, with the recent Xbox One exploits, people have found further ZFU versions that were never available on the 360. These ZFU versions work just as well on the 360, and you may be wondering how. Turns out, original Xbox games on the Xbox One are emulated through the Xbox 360 emulator. Yeah, two layers of emulation. That can't be efficient, but hey, I guess it works. Since a lot of this has only just been discovered, the community is still documenting how all of these games play, so if you give it a go, I highly recommend documenting your findings on the compatibility list on consolemods.org. As always, links are in the description. Now I should mention all of these things require a modded 360, and on that front, it's the same story as always. Your best bet is the reset glitch hack, for which you'll need a NAND flasher, maybe a glitch chip, and some moderate soldering ability, otherwise you're out of luck. You may have heard of a recent Tony Hawk exploit targeting the PS2, Xbox, and Xbox 360, and while on the PS2 and original Xbox this can be used to leverage existing softmod installers, it doesn't actually get us any closer to a 360 softmod. Game exploits on the 360 have been around as far back as 2006, most famously with a shader bug in King Kong. Back then, game exploits could be used to achieve unsigned code execution due to a bug in the 360's hypervisor. However, Microsoft quickly fixed that bug, and in the intervening 18 plus years, an equivalent hypervisor bug that would allow for unsigned code is yet to be discovered. This isn't to diminish the achievement in exploiting Tony Hawk, it's just to say that it doesn't do anything the King Kong exploit didn't already do. Until another hypervisor bug is found, we're still no closer to a softmod. That being said, it has gotten us talking about 360 modding again, which may lead to more people looking for an exploit. In that sense, maybe it has gotten us close to a softmod, just not in a technological sense. Now if you're looking for the easiest and most convenient way of playing 360 games, there is always Xenia, the first and currently still the only Xbox 360 emulator. Xenia has been progressing steadily since 2013 and has reached an impressive level of compatibility to the point that some games arguably run even better in Xenia than on actual hardware. That being said, the 360 is still a very complex console that requires a lot of power to emulate. don't expect to be able to play anything full speed unless you have a halfway decent gaming PC. And even then, compatibility is still far from 100%. Xenia is also a fairly bare-bones emulator. There are a lot of settings that aren't available in the app, instead requiring manual editing of configuration files. For an easier experience, you might want to look into Xenia Manager, a new tool that gives you a more user-friendly interface for using Xenia, even implementing auto-updates and individual settings for each game you play. This especially comes in handy when wanting to switch from an XBLA game to a disc game on the fly. It's not affiliated with the original Xenia project, but has already gained some popularity. If you're looking for the best possible, most compatible experience, you probably still want to get a modded Xbox 360, but Xenia is still very impressive and it will only continue to get better. Anyways, I have a feeling that despite the shutting down of the marketplace, the 360 is far from dead, and we're going to be hearing a lot more about it in the near future. Let me know in the comments if you end up trying any of this stuff yourself, but for now, I'll see you all in the next one. Bye guys.